little bit of history. It grew out of a project that I was on for a major healthcare company. And it was a realization, myself and a couple of BizTalk MVPs and some other people that were involved in the virtual TS program, that you know, there's this stuff that we just know and we just do when we get to a client site that a lot of people don't seem to know. And we just kind of do the same things at sites, and things change a little bit. Why don't we try to package some of this stuff up and make it available to the community? And that's where the ESB guidance began. So that's what it is it's a set of functionality built on top of BizTalk server that adds enterprise service bus capabilities to BizTalk. Okay, so I would strongly urge you to check it out. There's a community technology preview available right now. There is a dependency on BizTalk Server 2009. And for those of you that don't know it, I've been told, I haven't checked myself, but I've been told that that's available for download now at MSDN, right? So I hear. So you can go get that. You can install the ESB guidance CTP. And the final release of that should be soon. Soon as in not this week, next week, but not in 8 months. Somewhere between that. It should become available. So I'd encourage you to look that up. Secondly, so this is just way out in left field. As I was talking to some people, this kind of popped into my head. I'm not quite sure why. But it was an unusual thing that I did with BizTalk in response to an extremely, what to me anyhow, was an unusual requirement. And it led me to discover a little nook and cranny inside BizTalk that I'll bet most people in the room don't even know exists. So I'm going to talk about that, and later on there will be a PowerPoint slide for it in the next time I do this presentation. So the requirement was that we were sending out these files to a trading partner. And what we had to do was have a sequence number. So there was a batch number and there was a sequence number. And this file could be sent multiple times throughout the day, a variable number of times throughout the day, right? Might have been two times, might have been just once, could have been 30, right? So these things could go. So when you got to midnight, that batch number incremented and the sequence number reset to zero. Right, so every time you sent one of them, the sequence number would increment, but the batch number would increment on a day-by-day basis. How do you do that? How do you do that? You need to persist that number somewhere. How do you do that? Do you want me to tell you?
Separate database.
You could. That would work. You could put in a separate database. You could write a little helper component that goes out and gets it, and you increment that on a day-by-day basis. You check, is it still today or is it tomorrow now? Oh, it's tomorrow. I have to go out there and I have to change that, increment it. You could do that. Otherwise?
Singleton orchestration.
Singleton orchestration. Okay, so you've got an orchestration that's running the whole time. Keeping track of what today means and incrementing something. You could. You could put it in a config file. That's not what I did. So cross-referencing API. How many people have ever worked with that? Okay, that's what I figured. So that's most people don't know it's there, but it is there, and that's what I used. So you can write out to this thing. It's shared across all machines. So if you do something like a config file, right now you've got a problem because you've got multiple machines in the farm, so you have to synchronize things, right? So that won't work. But the cross-referencing API uses SQL Server. Right, so it's a shared repository for you. So that's how I did it. And then I checked, you know, is it a new day? If it is a new day, call into that and update it. So this is not intended to be a store for any kind of high volume transactions or anything like that. But in this particular case, it was kind of an ideal solution. So I can't remember if I did a blog post about it. I believe I did. And certainly Eric Stott did a blog post about it, and I think Tom Cantor might have done a blog post about it too. Tom helped me with this as I was going through this. He gave me some guidance, a little bit of help. Yes?
Did you store the sequence number in the cross-referencing, you mean the extract table?
Yeah.
Or just in the API, like in memory?
Using the API. So there's an just like all other parts of BizTalk, right? There's the API, right? An API that you can call. Yeah. Anyhow, thought I'd throw that out. Odds are, most people in the room will never need it. But you might run into something like what I ran into, and in that case, it's an ideal solution. Ha ha. Okay, hang on. Okay, have I said all of this? Not really. I haven't really said all of this. I said some of this, but not all of it. So I think BAM is an extremely important part of any BizTalk solution. I think if you go in there and you just automate a process, you've only done half the job, right? In order to really do it right, you need to have visibility into what's going on inside the process. I had a client where they had a very complex process. It was calling rules engine policies. There was like 1,800 policies or rules or something like that, massive numbers of that. And there was all kinds of helper components and lots of things that they were talking to. Just massive process. They knew when things came in. They knew when things came out. And sometimes if things went bad, something went wrong along the way, it would fall out the side. They had no idea what inside that time span was taking how long to execute. They had no idea. So what we did using BAM was we broke it up into subsystems, little logical subsystems, and we were able to give them a chart where they could see, oh, okay, so on this pie chart, I can see out of the 120 seconds it takes this whole thing to complete, 83 seconds are spent in this one space. Gee, that's longer than I thought. I wonder why, right? And we were also able to give them a chart that showed the same thing, but over time. So you can see the subsystem performance over time. Without using BAM, I mean, you could do it. And in the BizTalk 2004 world, a lot of people went down this path because they barely understood BizTalk. They didn't want to learn BAM. So the first thing they thought of when they did metrics tracking was, OK, I'll have some external table. And when I get to certain points, I'm going to record out that information, right? And you can do that. But what if you want to change it? What do you have to do? You have to do code changes. So you have to come back to this orchestration that you wrote out, you're calling the API or whatever to write stuff out. Now you have to make code changes in there. BAM works on an observation model. So it uses this notion of interceptors that get called at certain points when BizTalk is doing its magic. And if there's listeners, then it will capture information for you. It is completely decoupled from the BizTalk solution. So it's possible for you to do something like deploy a process out into production and then 6 months after say, you know what, I want to start tracking metrics about that. Do all your BAM stuff and deploy that without touching the running thing. Right? That's huge. The only time you would have to touch the running thing is if you want additional information that you're not currently passing through the system, which happens, right? You may have some other milestones that you want to capture. So it's an extremely important part of BizTalk. When you do presentations for your bosses, when you're trying to justify a project, I mean, showing a file disappear from one folder and show up in another folder, I mean, yeah, to us as BizTalk people, it's really exciting. We say, see, isn't that cool? It changed. But they don't see it the way we see it. But if you show them a pie chart, you show them a nice little graph, they like that, they get that. It communicates very effectively what the thing is doing, what the process is doing. That gets you budget allocation, and then you can go off and do the work.
Yeah, I think it's the best thing to add if you've built a proof of concept, even if you've only got 2 hours time on your hands, you can actually build quite a nice BAM implementation and show it running and just say, okay, we've built this, it does all what you ask for, and then we've added on this, and you can actually see the graphs and see things running. And for the amount of investment in time, if you understand the basics of how business activity monitoring working, you can build something simple in a couple of hours, which will really show off what BAM can do.
Yep. And then, I mean, the nice part about this too is that BAM is using just standard stuff, right? It's using, if you're doing real-time aggregations, it's going into SQL Server tables. If you're doing scheduled aggregations, it's going into analysis services, standard cubes, right? These are standard things. You can take those, you can hand them to a more junior person that works in reporting services, and they can generate some reports off of that. It's not a high-level developer task anymore. Anyone that knows how to use reporting services can jump over there and do that. Right, so extremely important. It's a really powerful tool. A lot of products in other technology spaces charge big bucks for this capability, and you've got it. It's installed. You have it at your disposal. there's APIs. So you can do things like have a .NET web service call into the BAM API and register the fact that something has happened, a milestone's happened, or I've received some data. You can do all that. There's WCF interceptors now. So you can do, using channel annotations or behaviors I think, capture information flowing through WCF services very naturally in a WCF kind of way. Okay, so if you haven't looked at it, check it out. There are webcasts available. I've done a couple of webcasts. Other people have done webcasts. There's a good white paper from Jesus Rodriguez available on MSDN right now. There's, I think, Aaron Sconner did one. There's a book coming out, Professional BAM, right? So there's a reason why so many people are doing this. My client that had the big monolithic thing, once they found out what was going on inside, it really changed the way they did things. Like, they were able to isolate some problems that they didn't know they had. Right? So again, this is one of those things where, is there a cost up front? Yes, there is. Is it worth doing it? Yeah, absolutely. It's going to give you much better visibility into what you're doing, and it's going to save you potentially problems down the road. Right? If you've got a trend analysis chart and you see over time, well, this trading service, this trading partner's web service that I'm calling, it's degrading over time, right? That tells you something, and you might be able to solve a problem before you have the problem. Okay, I'll try not to preach anymore. See, you have BAM, use it.
The client we're working with, they want to have end-to-end tracking and message or flow through different systems. And they want to be able to track a message from start to end, mm-hmm. not just through this talk.
Right.
Do you know, do you have any ideas how you could do
anything? So the question is, at a client, they want to track a message end to end, not only while it's inside BizTalk, while it's going through other processes as well. So yes, you can. So there is an API available, right? So you can put API calls wherever you like. There's four different APIs available. They serve different purposes and they're intended for different purposes. There is a direct synchronous call.
We're aware of those.
Okay.
Somehow you have a unique identifier.
A continuation?
Yeah, for the message.
Right.
I mean, if the message, say, starts at a store,
right.
How do you get a unique identifier for that message?
So the message starts somewhere and there's some kind of a unique identifier.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
Right, so a couple of things. There's activity IDs that are associated with the BAM profile, and there's also something called continuations. And the intention and the continuation may or may not be applicable, but the intent, the idea behind that is you have an order system and you've got order 1, 2, 3, and then it flows over to an invoicing system and you've got invoice 4, 5, 6, and you want to say that those two are actually the same transaction and you want to capture it together.
But the challenge is what when the message starts at, say, for instance, at a store.
Right.
You don't have that. I could say if the message ID is the activity ID, you don't have that at that point.
Oh, okay. Well, so the store, okay, so the message starts at the store. They may not have whatever context properties or activity IDs that you've got, but they've got something inside that message, probably some kind of a reference number. You can use that as your activity ID going through.
Maybe we can.
Okay, or failing that.
Yeah, from the client side, you could start there, actually use activity ID, and then it will generate one, and then it will come into your BizTalk with an activity ID, and BizTalk will preserve that, and it will flow it on. So, but if you have WCF on the starter part of your application, then you can generate, actually, you can have activities ID in your messages.
You don't have to use the automatically generated activity IDs. You can specify where that activity ID comes from. Okay. So with BAM, you can, a little bit of a sidebar, not ducking your question. But with BAM, there's two things that you can track. You can track business milestones, so start process, end order, that sort of thing. or you can track data, the thing flowing through. And the thing flowing through breaks down even further because you now have the ability to track context properties and actual values inside the message too. They don't have to be promoted. Anything inside that message is fair game. So in your case, if it's coming from a cash register, point of sale terminal, or something like that, there's probably some kind of a transaction ID that they're using, and you can use that to flow through and make that the activity ID. So when you receive it, you're beginning an activity, the API is begin activity, right? And you use that as the activity ID, potentially. Is that fit? You're not sure.
The thing is, it's not always a cash register, it may be a SAP system, so somehow we need to like have a generic identifier for messages. Maybe I can explain it to you.
Yeah, so there's any number of things you could do. I mean, you could have a pipeline component that stamps something in there, right, based on something you've got elsewhere. Right, stamp a transaction ID into it or something, but that you still have to correlate that back to wherever it came from, and that's a bit of a problem, right? In order to correlate it back, you need to know something about back there, right? So if they have a number, some kind of identifier number, a transaction ID or something, you could use that, and then that would give you the end to end. So you have BAM, use it. Yeah, so probably everyone does this, right? You have your own internal canonical representations of things. So you have a bunch of trading partners that place orders with you, but you have your internal representation of what an order looks like. And that's not what you expose to the outside world. They may have their own flavors of it, and it's mapping back to your canonical order, right? So of course we want to do it this way. Otherwise, we're going to have to do different order processes for each of these different order types, or we're going to have to do something like an order process that says, well, if it's this, do that. If it's this, do that, right? So it just gets a lot messier. The rule of thumb is to transform as early as possible into your canonical format, and to change back as late as possible. Okay. Okay, so this is getting a bit dated because that probably applies to Windows Server 2008 as well. So Windows ships out of the box with some default settings that are going to be right for most people that are using it as a file server, right? That's not necessarily going to be best for what you have and for what your situation is. There's a white paper that's kind of misnamed on optimizing BizTalk databases or something like that, available on MSDN, written by a former colleague of mine, John Brockmeyer, that goes into painstaking detail. And I mean painstaking. If you've seen this thing, it's 150 pages, and it's not light reading. This is pretty deep stuff. And it goes into a whole bunch of detail about knobs and dials that you have at your access that you can use to control performance. Okay? So it's a very, very good resource. I think I've got a link later on to it. But it's a really good resource. However, you shouldn't, two things, you shouldn't let it intimidate you. Don't let it scare you or say, that's it, I'm leaving BizTalk forever. And also don't blindly do everything it says because that's not the idea. Right? As John puts it, before you do anything that's in there, understand what it is you're about to do, understand why you think you need to do that, and then write down that you did that. So when you move it to a different environment, you can recreate those things.
But it's 100 threads enough for that?
Is 100 threads enough to read John's paper? No, you need 200 threads.
This data to 100 threads.
This is the guidance. Now, this may change with Windows 2008, I don't know.
I mean, the standard value that you get now in .NET, it's like 250 threads, IO threads and worker threads per processor. So what they have here, it's like 100 threads, IO threads and 100 worker threads.
Yeah, I'm not sure. check John's paper. Okay. John's paper is the Bible, right? Okay. So John is the guy that went to Redmond and spent 3 weeks with the BizTalk team showing them how to tune SQL Server to optimize it for BizTalk. Okay. I've had the pleasure of working closely with him on a couple of projects. He's very, very deep on all of this stuff. So, I mean, I look to him for these sorts of things. I highly recommend that paper. Along the same lines, the BizTalk Operations Guide, is everyone familiar with that? No? Okay, so that's a great resource too. I think I have a link. But it's also it's a very valuable resource because it kind of pulls together, just like the Blogger's Guide does, pulls together things that various people have done and puts it in a form that you can just go through it. And I highly recommend that people new to BizTalk take a look at it, read through it, because it touches everything from planning, through capacity planning, right, through to backup strategies and everything. So I suggest that people read that through to at least be aware of what's in it, and then read it through again 6 months later, and then read it through again after that too. Because there's some really good information in there. Yeah, you guys are really lucky to have such a strong community here. I have not seen as strong a BizTalk user group anywhere in the world, so you're really lucky. It used to be a little bit of a problem, right? BizTalk kind of black sheep in 2004 world. You know, people, yeah, I do BizTalk. but it's a lot better now. And now it's a lot more people are seeing the value, the integration server role that it's playing with BizTalk Server 2009 and layering on the ESB guidance and the SharePoint integration, all that stuff, and using it as a platform to do SOA infrastructure, are making it a more widely used platform, more broadly accepted. As an offshoot of that, there's a lot more people doing it. And because there's a lot more people doing it, there's a lot more people talking about it. So there's a wealth of resources out there. Use them.
Yeah, I remember back in the day in BizTalk 2004, we're waiting for the BizTalk book to come out. And now we've got a shelf of books and so much more people blogging. I mean, yep. A city like Stockholm to have so many people here tonight is just showing how popular the product is.
Yep. This is not summary for everything. Don't worry, you're not going to get to leave yet. This is just a summary of this part. So we've said all this. I really do want to stress the second, third, fourth point, right? It doesn't need to be hard. Development doesn't need to be hard. Deployment doesn't need to be hard. You can make it hard, right? But it doesn't have to be. So if you put a little bit of foresight in, you put a little bit of planning in, you invest some time up front in doing things like structured things, folder structures, deployment scripts, doing your metrics, tracking profiles, if you put that investment in, it's going to pay off big time down the road. And it'll make your careers as a BizTalk developer much happier, it'll make your bosses and clients happier, and the world will be a better place. And I guess I'll get you the slides.
Yeah.
So we've got a bunch of links here. Yeah, lots and lots of links. Does everyone know about BizTalk blogs? You guys know about that? Okay, well that's the most important thing you've heard here tonight then. So it's kind of misnamed because it's not just BizTalk oriented, but it's anything to do with BizTalk, with SOA, with WCF, WF. It's a collection of different bloggers. You're there, right?
Yeah.
You're there.
I don't think I'm there. I mean, Steve Thomas has also got an aggregation on BizTalk Gurus, which has mostly the same. There's a few different ones in there as well.
Right. Yeah, so these things are out there giving you like single points that you can go to and get a lot of information. And yeah, books. Look at that. And I think there's more now. There are more now. There's even some self-published ones that have, like, who wrote that? but there's a wealth of materials available. Okay. You can tell we've completely planned this well in advance and rehearsed for months, right? Okay. You want to start?
Yeah, so shall I take the mic off?
Sure.
So originally, I'd planned sort of running this maybe as its own session, doing a big session looking at all the stuff we can do with administration in BizTalk Server. And I decided since Brian was in town, it would be sort of ideal to tag on to the end of the development best practices. So we're not going to go through sort of all of what you should be doing, everything you should be doing for BizTalk Server administration. Just look at some of the basics. You've probably got a lot of experience as well with seeing customers in large-scale BizTalk deployments. I mean, in Sweden, I think we tend to consider a large-scale BizTalk deployment as an active passive SQL cluster and a couple of BizTalk boxes. We tend to have sort of smaller scale environments. And what typically have you seen on BizTalk deployments as a large-scale deployment?
So the perhaps the most interesting one that I've been involved with was the healthcare company, where it was 56 processors, and this is going back a few years, and it wasn't just the deployment itself, but it was everything around that. So everything had to be high availability. We're talking healthcare information, right? So, I mean, if you've got an order processing system, you lose an order, that's bad. You've got a healthcare system, you lose a diagnosis, somebody could die, right? So this is really critical, critical information. So nothing could go wrong. We had to have everything high availability. So what we had was we had groups of six machines. We had a couple machines doing receiving, using the BizTalk host instances. We had a couple of machines doing receiving, a couple of machines doing processing, a couple of machines doing sending. Everything high availability. That was all backed by SQL, high performance SAN behind everything, right? And highly optimized. So John's paper goes into that, structuring your LUNs, right? How you should set up the different file groups in SQL Server for optimal performance. We did all that. We had MQ series, high availability, and not just that, we had two flavors of it. So we had a Windows MQ series and a Solaris MQ series. It was a heterogeneous environment. There was some Java stuff going on, so we had JMS stuff. We had high availability file shares. Who knew you could do that? Right? It never really occurred to me to do that, but yeah, you can. You just set it up on the SAN and you've got it. It's there. So we did all of that. We had high availability. There was no single point of failure anywhere in this entire system. Then we had another data center on the other side of the country with the same setup. So if there was a nuclear event of some sort and the entire data center was lost, we would be able to flip over. Would there be a message loss in that case? Yeah, there might be. Because we're using log shipping, so depending on the frequency of the playback of the logs and exactly when the mushroom cloud started, there might be some messages lost. But the setup we had, everything was just as optimized as we could possibly make it. There was a very big pipe running across the country, right, to make this as high performance as possible. That's an extreme example.
So I've mentioned here a few of the challenges. BizTalk can be seen as being a complex product. We work with it every day. You know, we've spent time, we've invested time to understand how BizTalk works. So we do have a core of understanding on it. But especially with IT pros who are typically very familiar with Windows, with working with Active Directory, with working with products like SQL Server, they're very good at what they do in those domains. And suddenly throwing them over something like BizTalk Server and saying, you know, okay, look after this as well. It's your responsibility to manage BizTalk Server. It can be challenging to actually get IT pros up to speed. We do have specialized backups in BizTalk Server. The BizTalk Server backup job is not like a regular SQL Server backup job. Understanding that and being able to communicate that to database administrators can be challenging. I think in the old days, the favorite thing to do was to get Lee Graeber to actually phone up the database administrator and tell them in very strong words why they should be using BizTalk Server's backup job and not using their own backup jobs. And I've been involved in a couple of projects, especially in the early days when you did have these types of discussions.
Actually, that's documented. Sorry, that is documented. Lee did write somewhere in a blog post, I believe. This is when your DBA says, we have our own backup process already, thank you very much, and we'll use ours. This is what you tell him. So it basically, the thing is that we do cross-database transactions here, and it uses the BizTalk backup job uses transaction mark logs to track all of that. So you can use your own backup process if you like. However, your integrity may be compromised when you have to restore. So it doesn't work that way.
Yeah, I mean, I've put this down sort of from my own perspective. It's not saying all developers, but typically I tend to, you know, what, like building stuff, seeing how stuff works, testing stuff. You know, if something crashes, I just, you know, terminate the orchestration, reboot it. It doesn't really affect me that much. So I tend to don't have the sort of, maybe not the right discipline, the right sort of mindset to work as an administrator, where we have to, you know, think about these mission critical systems that have to be up and running. There's certain practices, certain ways that we should do things, certain things that we should, certain practices that administrators should be following. Hosting companies often treat BizTalk Server as a customer application. So you're going in and saying, okay, we want you to install BizTalk Server. And they're, okay, what is it? Oh, it's a server product by Microsoft. And it's kind of like, falls somewhere in between. You know, if we've built an application, we want them to host it, we're expected to understand how to administrate that application. If it's something like SQL Server or something like SharePoint, you know, the administrators should understand how SQL works or should understand how SharePoint works. But very often they don't have the experience of BizTalk Server. So they kind of say, okay, this BizTalk thing, it's kind of like something that they're giving us, and the actual company is going to understand how it works, and we're not going to have to actually invest too much in understanding how that works. So it comes down at the bottom line, you know, who is responsible for the BizTalk production environment? Who do you call in when things start going wrong? Whose responsibility is it to keep that system up and running? So danger signals that you may come across, and I have heard these on more than one product project, and you will have probably heard them yourselves. So, first one, can you send us a Word document that tells us how to install BizTalk? And I've heard this coming from various companies, various people that are asking this. You know, typically if you're dealing with a company and you're saying, okay, we want a SQL Server database, and it says, okay, can you send us a Word document that tells us how to install SQL Server? You'd probably go find another hosting company. So typically this does happen, that just basically people aren't used to having BizTalk Server in their environment. So finding people who do understand how BizTalk Server works. If you do get in that situation, then as developers, you can probably mentor people who are going to be hosting your environments as to how they should be installing BizTalk Server. Spend some time with them. Make sure they get the appropriate training. And don't just treat it as sort of handing off a document. Make sure that you actually run and walk them through the installation procedure. It can be complex. And also, as well as installing BizTalk Server, you've got the post-installation tasks, the log shipping, and all these stuff that you need to be doing, thinking about looking after BizTalk. We don't use MOM or Microsoft Operations Manager or System Center Operations Manager. We have our own monitoring software. Monitoring BizTalk Server can be very critical. Having the right management packs in MOM and all this type of stuff, you know, really, I really highly recommend using Microsoft Operations Manager. There are other options, other software vendors, but having the right configuration to actually monitor BizTalk Server is critical as well. We have our own procedures for database backups. Very often, people who are working with SQL Server, they're very good at what they do, and they will be looking after, you know, a large number of databases, maybe sort of 50, 100 databases on a database server. And if you come in and install BizTalk Server, you're typically generating maybe sort of between 4 and 14 additional databases on a database somewhere. As far as they're concerned, they're just databases. We'll just run this in the regular backup procedure with all of the other stuff. As we've been mentioning before, we do have this special way of backing up BizTalk Server because of the way that BizTalk Server works with transactions. So we do need to ensure that that procedure is running. How big are these databases going to get? It's causing issues with our backups. Typical one is the tracking database. You go in and install BizTalk Server, but you do not set the actual purge and archive on the tracking database. So I always ask this when I'm asking, teaching the deep dive course, what's the largest tracking database that anybody has seen in BizTalk Server? Any offers? Have you got any examples?
I had one where the client said, gee, BizTalk seems to be really disk intensive. It's like up to 60 gig. So we bought more disk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
True story.
Yeah, that beats the record because the last one was about 35 gig on a tracking database. And, you know, the tracking database can get so big that you can't actually see what's going on. You can't actually query it because there's so much information in there. So this kind of management things, if people aren't aware, you know, you go in and install BizTalk Server, stuff starts running fine. You know, sort of 3 months later, stuff is still running fine. In a year's time or in 2 years' time, you can end up with these really large tracking databases. Another one, you know, if the message box database gets large, that can start causing issues in BizTalk Server products. So, I mean, are you fairly familiar with these arguments? Have you seen these appearing?
Yep. pretty common. And one thing about the MOM SCOM stuff too, these give you deep visibility, so that gives you some the ability to do some pretty interesting things. So you can do things like control host instances. So if you think back to my example of having two receiving machines, two processing, two sending, as a best practice, you would of course deploy all to those machines equally, right? So everything's deployed to all the machines are identical. And then you could toggle host instances. You can have MOM do that or SCOM do that for you too. So it can do something because it's got such deep visibility. You can do things like notice, oh, the processing machines seem to be getting a little bit overwhelmed. I'm going to turn on the processing host over on the send box to have it help out and start participating in the workload. And then generate an email for the admin saying, oh, by the way, you're about to have a problem. Here's how I fixed it. Of course, you could script all that, right?
So I think one thing when you're thinking about administration, and this is quite important, is to recognize that BizTalk Server Administrator is a dedicated role. And back in the early days, you know, they were saying, oh, well, we've got this BizTalk project, and it's normally the developers who look after the administration. You typically had all the slide decks on the courses that had the, you know, the business analyst, the information worker, the developer, and the IT pro, who all did different things within a BizTalk Server project. But it was mostly the developer who was doing this stuff. Nowadays, we are starting to see people working, especially as BizTalk gets more popular and a more mature product. People are starting to take on the responsibility of a BizTalk Server administrator. They will be looking after the BizTalk Server environment. Allow appropriate time for training and education. We do have, there's a quick learn 5-day BizTalk administrator course. If you want to go sort of fully through and work with multi-server environments, do a multi-server install, multi-server deployments, you can attend that course. We also, I've done webcasts on doing a multi-server environment using virtual PC. So you can play around with this stuff at home if you've got enough memory on your actual host machine. Install a multi-server environment on your own PC and virtual machines, and then play around with it, see how it is resilient to failure. See if you can get the log shipping working in a virtual environment. Developers, because we've an understanding of how BizTalk Server works with the deployment, we understand what can go wrong with BizTalk Server deployments. We understand the error messages. We're in a good position to be able to mentor administration personnel and be able to bring them up to speed. Start to get serious with administrating your test environments. So when you are installing your test environment, be a good idea to install MOM on that test environment or System Center Operations Manager. It's also, SCOM has great performance counters, so it tracks all the performance counters. I think is it every 15 minutes it will record a lot of the BizTalk performance counters. And you can go back and see like how many orchestrations you're processing over time and all kinds of stuff like that. So I tend to say to people, you know, treat your sort of a test environment, pretend it's your administration environment as you run through doing all the installations. Make sure you're doing the same thing with your tracking configuration, your BizTalk backups. Even practice doing restores, restoring the BizTalk databases on that machine as well, and monitoring that as well, being able to provide errors and feedback and so on.
So that's a really good point too, is the perfmon counters. So be aware that those are there. Because that can sometimes give you good insights into what's going on inside the system if something's slowing down. If you bring up perfmon, there's a set of counters that are under the word BizTalk, but then there's also another one right down at the bottom under xlang-s that gives you visibility into what's going on in orchestration, so you can throw up a graph of orchestrations created per second or completed per second or in process, things like that. Can be useful.
And I think the way that SCOM works, as soon as you've installed it and started monitoring a BizTalk server system, I think every 15 minutes it takes the performance counters and it archives them in a database. So if you've got a performance problem with your BizTalk server, you can say, well, how many how many orchestrations or how many persistence points are we generating? How many messages received per second or what's the receive latency? You can go back in time over a couple of months and see, you know, well, when did this problem start? You know, was it when we deployed this application or when we connected up this this trading partner? Database administration. We should all know this if we're working as BizTalk Server developers. After you've installed BizTalk Server, you enable and use the BizTalk Server backup job in SQL Server Agent. Is it? Yeah. Configure and run the BizTalk Server backup job. Ensure that the tracking purge and archive is running. Typically, we just purge the tracking database in a development environment. We may want to archive it in a production environment. Backup your ESSO master secret. Now, this is usually done for you when you install BizTalk Server, and by default, it's generated in one of the actual system folders. And normally, developers, we just install it. We type in the password confirmation and password reminder, and we don't do anything with that. We just leave it there because we're not too critical about restoring a development environment. But you need to think about this more in a production environment.
And what can happen if you don't have that and something happens to your SSO database and you need to restore this? The SSO database is, of course, where all your binding information lives, right? So if you don't have this backed up somewhere, then you could wind up in a world of rebuilding things that may not be very pleasant. So that's an important, really important step.
Yeah, additions to that is the BizTalk log shipping. Now, when BizTalk Server 2004 was released, there was no such thing as BizTalk log shipping. There was sort of the way of being able to back up the databases. But actually restoring a BizTalk group to a stable state was very challenging. So I think it was, I think it was Service Pack 1 for BizTalk Server 2004. They added on the BizTalk log shipping in that first Service Pack for BizTalk Server 2004. And now in BizTalk Server 2006, R2 and 2009, this is the only sort of documented and supported way of being able to do BizTalk Server backups. So if you read through the BizTalk Server documentation, when it talks about restoring your BizTalk Server databases, it starts talking about your log shipping destination SQL Server. So you need to think about, you know, are we going to configure this? Are we going to use this? Do we have another way of doing disaster recovery? This is sort of where my knowledge starts to peter out, because I've done the BizTalk log shipping stuff. I've worked with it. We teach it on the administrator course because it's the recommended and supported way. But if you ever see somebody called Ewan Fairweather who's presenting, and if you speak to Paolo tomorrow night, he will know alternative methods. Maybe you know about using, the SAN drives. Different ways of being able to store data, different ways of being able to actually work with disaster recovery. You should understand how log shipping works, be able to know how to configure it, and then maybe look at alternative ways of working out with BizTalk Server.
So for the log shipping part of it, if you're log shipping to a DR center somewhere else, you don't, from a licensing perspective, you don't really have to have the BizTalk machines running. Right. They, depending on what your needs are in a failover, in case a failover event happens, the BizTalk machines, if you can tolerate an outage, the BizTalk machines could be down. You could have as little as one SQL server sitting there replaying the logs as they come in, but there should be at least one active and replaying the logs so that if you do have a failover event occur, that you don't have to start replaying all the logs, right? That it's pretty well ready to go.
So how many people have actually implemented log shipping on a BizTalk group?
How many people have ever had a hard drive fail on them?
It was interesting because I think when Darren Jefford was here, who was presenting, he was talking about BizTalk deployments in the UK. And he was mentioning, you know, everybody, he says, well, everybody uses log shipping, and sort of went on talking when I asked a question. I was kind of thinking of asking that question then. I kind of think that it is really important at least to gain an understanding of that. Maybe it's a good topic to do a webcast on that. But definitely, you know, the backup is half the story. We need to understand how the log shipping works to be able to do a restore. BizTalk should be monitored using MOM or SCOM or some kind of other monitoring software that will provide that. And also monitoring SQL Server as well using some kind of a monitoring capability. Yeah?
Well, the obvious question, of course, is why? You just can't state something like that and not saying why. Why should I use MOM or SCOM? Why not? Database guys, they develop some kind of monitoring software for themselves or by themselves.
Good question is don't take my word for it. Why should we actually use MOM or SCOM? I've got an actual slide which will be covering that, so I'll go through that in a bit more detail. Monitor SQL Server as well using some kind of monitoring server. You know, what happens if your tracking database gets to be 5 gigabytes? What happens if your BizTalk Server backup job fails? Or if your message box cleanup jobs start taking 60 minutes to run instead of a few seconds? That should start alarms flashing. So SQL Server, because BizTalk is so dependent on SQL Server, it's important to have a stable SQL Server running. Disaster recovery. Backup is only half the story. If you can't restore, disaster recovery becomes disaster. And this is something that should be practiced. You know, I've seen scenarios where they've said, you know, you should be practicing your disaster recovery on a monthly basis. I've not seen that, and that may be a bit of an extreme case, but I think running through and just trying to do a BizTalk server restore is going to frighten you because of how challenging it is going to be. It does get easier the more you do it. I think Ewan Fairweather is doing a presentation. He's one of the BizTalk Rangers now. He was talking about disaster recovery in BizTalk Server and says, you know, first time they tried it, they couldn't even get the databases restored in a stable state. There was something they'd forgotten in the backup procedure. Next time they tried it, it probably took them all day to get it up and running. And then they took it down to about 3 hours. And eventually they got it down to about sort of 5 minutes to be able to actually get another BizTalk system up and running. I think I ran through and I've demoed it in the log shipping, and I can actually run through a demo, and I think I have about sort of 5 minutes downtime doing it in a virtual environment. And with scripting, you can actually bring it down to smaller periods of time. So definitely look at, consider log shipping, maybe look at using SAN-based systems, and talk to somebody who is experienced. One of the BizTalk Rangers will be able to help you out with providing information about that. Practice disaster recovery procedures, so you can either do this in a virtual environment. Your test environment is a very good option to use there as well. Also, your development environment. I actually had this. I was going in to do a presentation on BizTalk Server, and I had my laptop with me. I've never seen it before, but I actually started up my laptop, and I got a message saying that the BizTalk service failed to start because there was some corruption in the management database or the message box database. But basically, I was mainly presenting in front of clients, and I had no BizTalk. When one of my colleagues was presenting, I actually managed to unconfigure BizTalk Server, delete the databases, reconfigure BizTalk Server, and get it back up and running again in about 15 minutes before I actually had to run the demonstration. So even getting a development environment, being able to actually run through the disaster recovery procedures, understanding how stuff works, is going to be useful. Master Secret Server. When BizTalk Server was first released, they were basically saying, okay, the Master Secret Server should be installed on a separate active-passive Windows cluster. And did you have experience of that? Do people actually buy a separate active-passive Windows cluster for the enterprise single sign-on?
No, I think most people wind up using a SQL cluster.
Yeah, what people were doing was a lot of people were saying, well, we can't afford this. We've got two BizTalk servers. We'll have one of the BizTalk servers hosting the Enterprise Single Sign-On Master Secret Server and the other one hosting the actual backup. And there is a failover procedure where you can actually move the Master Secret Server from one box across to another box. But what they're actually recommending now, it's actually if you go and look at the sort of sample high availability installation scenarios in the documentation, they do actually have the Master Secret Server on the same active-passive cluster as they are using for SQL Server. The MSS restore is fairly basic. There's a bunch of scripts, again, that we can use to actually restore these, and some XML configuration files. So it maybe take you an hour or so to actually run through and figure out how to do a restore of this master secret. But if you've gone through and you've got the procedure, you've got the script, you understand how it works, and you've got the sample XML configuration file, you can do it in a few minutes to actually get that restore running. You do need to have the master secret in to actually be able to actually run that restore. You should also be aware of the security implementations, because if I've got your Enterprise Single Sign-On Master Secret and I've got a copy of your SSO database, the credentials database, I can go in and recreate that database and get access to all of the binding configurations. So if you do have any sort of critical information in there, make sure that you do take the appropriate security precautions with the Master Secret. Okay, back to, you know, why we should use Microsoft Operations Manager or Systems Center Operations Manager. They have these things called management packs. Now, the rule at Microsoft, I think as I understand it, is that the team who develops BizTalk Server are responsible for delivering a management pack to the SCOM team that contains all of the stuff that will go wrong with BizTalk Server. Is that the case?
Not entirely sure. I believe so.
Yeah, that's what I heard, basically, is that the people who are responsible for building the product, they fully understand how all the errors go. They understand everything that can go wrong. So they supply this management pack to the System Center Operations Manager team. So BizTalk has 50 events, over 50 events that we're monitoring. Enterprise Single Sign-On also has over 50 events. So that's 100 things that you've got to be looking at with BizTalk Server. And that is already configured in the actual management packs within System Center Operations Manager. So instead of saying, a warning coming up saying, we failed to communicate with a certain system, this message will be redelivered after the retry interval specified in the send port. It will give you a much better description aimed at administrators who may not have a full sort of deep technical knowledge of BizTalk Server. So it provides sort of three categories, the cause, the sort of possible resolution, and the action that they can take. These sort of English descriptions over what we should be doing. You're able to configure it to email certain people at certain times, be able to alert people with what's going on in the BizTalk Server system. If you don't have this management pack, you've basically got to prepare a list with these sort of 100 errors and warnings that you're going to be sending to people to actually tell them how to understand how BizTalk Server works. And that tends to get too complex. So they say, well, can't we just send you an email message every time an error occurs within BizTalk Server? BizTalk's very verbose. It basically logs, sort of two errors every time you get a suspended message. So if a batch comes in and you get maybe 20, 30, even 1,000 suspended messages, you're going to be getting all of these emails and all of these events being generated. The way that MOM works is that when you get an error, it treats that as, something's wrong with the BizTalk server system. And if that error occurs again, something's wrong with the BizTalk server system and it's happened a second time. And if it's happened 1,000 times, it's still the same alert within Microsoft Operations Manager. So it handles that very well, being able to actually treat and resolve these events. Some warning events can highlight critical problems. So if your Enterprise Single Sign-On Master Secret Server goes down and the BizTalk systems can't talk to that Master Secret Server, they will give you a warning and say that Enterprise Single Sign-On cannot talk with the Master Secret Server. And that warning may get lost amongst a bunch of errors that are suspended messages. So the warnings can be very critical in some scenarios. So it's good, to start alarm bells ringing if we do get certain warnings coming from certain systems. Back to ESP guidance for the last point. Do you want to add something about this?
We keep coming back to that, don't we? Gee, it must be important if we keep coming back to it. So it ships with a portal, and I was speaking with someone at the break about this. There is a portal that ships with it. That portal is intended as a sample. Okay, it's not, this is what you deploy to production, this is what you give your business people access to. It's intended as a sample. But more importantly than that, it gives you that whole framework that we were talking about. So you've got the ability to write different listeners that will operate on messages that are generated by the exception subsystem. What would I do? I would put it in that process portal that I keep talking about. So the people that are in charge of the care and feeding of the actual process, the ones that own the process, will be told about the problems, right? Assuming it's the sort of problem that they can fix, as opposed to an IT admin type problem.
So I think it tends to work at a bit of a higher level than MOM. Yeah. It won't tell you about the master secret server failing or all this type of stuff, but dealing with failed messages, stuff that goes on at the BizTalk server application level.
Right. Yeah, so with MOM and everything, you get deep visibility into what's going on at a hardware level, right? Like deep down, what's the size of the spool table, things like that, or how much memory is available. That's the sort of information you can get out of that. You'll never get that from the ESP guidance.
So getting skills with BizTalk administration, I think the way that I sort of learned a lot of stuff was just playing around with virtual environments for multi-server installations. So I've got a webcast where I have one machine that's running a domain controller or a SQL server and my master secret server. I've then got another two machines that are each running BizTalk server, and I can create a group when I install one machine, join a group with another machine. And once you've got these sort of three machines running in a multi-server environment, you can then start to look at, well, how do I deploy to a multi-server environment? How do I configure to disaster recovery? You can even add on another virtual machine that's running Microsoft Operations Manager or System Center Operations Manager, install the management packs and see how they work when you start getting exception errors occurring. I think with MOM there was a requirement to have a domain controller somewhere in the scenario, and you could not install MOM on a domain controller. So I think you did need a multi-server environment. I'm not sure if it's the same with System Center Operation Manager or if there's a workaround. I think, as Brian was mentioning, there is a BizTalk Server Administration Guide, which is a CHM document, which is a lot of the documentation that is on the web that has been sort of pulled off and put in the CHM format. So that's a really good starting point. And lastly, we do have the 5-day quick learn course, BizTalk for Administrators. We started looking at the 2-day administration course that is the actual mock course, the official course, which is okay for developers who want to learn a bit about administration, but it doesn't really cover the multi-server environments. So that drills into a lot of depth, working with a lot of multi-server environments, multi-server labs, and so on. So we're hosting that at Informata every now and again. So you've probably got a lot of stories from the field. We've probably got another couple of minutes. Maybe anything you want to add to this?
No, that about sums it up. No, I think we've conveyed a lot of information here. We don't want to overflow anyone out there. Does anyone have any open questions about anything? BizTalk related? Not soccer, football, or anything like that. I think we hurt them. They're full.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you all. Hopefully this was beneficial. Hopefully you got something out of this. Hopefully you'll start learning BAM and ESP guidance, and you can't wait to go and download SCUMM. And hopefully this will help you, and you'll get to do some of these things, and it will improve what you're doing.